Your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Revolution with Juan McCartney is sponsored by Alive, Burger King, Commonwealth Bank, J.S. Johnson, Marcos Pizza, NUA Insurance Agents and Brokers, Ron's Electric Motors, and Season of Love.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Apologize for a really late start today. I was set to come from my house over Zoom, and then the internet kicked out. And that was about 12:10. Then I had to drive here in terribly frustrating traffic. And here we are, and, you know, only the good Lord Jehovah and my commitment to a guest in the second hour today as why we're not playing a replay. It's a frustrating experience to try to come and go through all that frazzle-dazzle and then start broadcasting, but such is life. Let's all be thankful we're here. Okay, so I was going to talk about Sam Bankman-Fried, and I will in a moment, because he's getting weird now. But well, he's been weird, but it's starting to scare me now. I wanted to talk about one story that I saw, and not so much about what it tells me about society and how we're moving. And this isn't a bad thing. I just wanted to highlight it. So this is CIBC to remove many in-person services focusing on alternative banking channels. All right, this is by Chester Robards in today's Guardian. This says, CIBC First Caribbean in the Bahamas and Turks and Caicos will no longer process transactions at a teller that can be carried out through alternative banking channels beginning January 3rd, the bank said in a memo. The memo said those alternative channels include instant tellers and smart automated banking machines, night depositories, online banking, and the bank's mobile app. Bank said after January 3rd, it won't facilitate cash and check deposit, check cashing corporate and small business deposits, withdrawals under $3,000 ABM daily limit, credit card payments, bill payments, domestic and international transfers, transfers between CIBC First Caribbean accounts, and transfers to other CIBC First Caribbean clients and third-party transfers. It added that while opening a personal or a sole proprietorship account will also not be done at a branch, those wanting to open a joint account or those who are politically exposed will have to visit a branch. Okay? It says the change supports the bank's vision of delivering a modern digital banking experience, which is personalized, easy, and convenient. It also supports our frontline teams by freeing up capacity to focus on providing additional value-added service and service to our clients. So CIBC said, it's unfortunate that an internal briefing document that was meant to prepare our team for the cessation of payments over the counter has been circulated in the public domain prior to the bank circulating communications to the public on the matter. We encourage our clients who need additional support to perform transactions on our digital platforms to reach out to our branch teams who are there to provide that assistance. Our digital banking officers will be on hand to show clients how to use the ABM to make deposits, transfers, or to get cash during the transaction. The fact is that since the days of the pandemic, when no one was allowed in our branches for transaction of any kind, we've been preparing our clients for this change. It's also a fact that at this stage, a very small percentage of our clients are still coming into the branches to make payments. We've continued to observe a noticeable decline in clients performing over-the-counter transactions. With advancement in our digital service, there's been an increasingly greater number of clients who wish to execute their transactions in a safe, easy, and convenient manner through our alternative channels. The statement said, more than 85% of the bank's clients now perform much of their transactions online. And First Caribbean is not alone. Some banks have completely closed branches. Other banks have said there's no tellers at this location, XYZ. Other banks say there's no ATMs at this location. Now, I'm a this isn't a knock on First Caribbean. I'm a First Caribbean customer, and I'm very pleased with their service. All right? It's no shade to anyone else, but it's the best regular transactional service that I've experienced in the Bahamas, particularly since the arrival of First Caribbean. So I don't have a problem with First Caribbean at all. All right, but it signals to me that what they're doing is the general thrust of what where a lot of this is going. But it signals to me that we may be moving so fast toward this aim of digitization that we leave a lot of people behind. If it's 85% of the people who do most of their banking online, fine. But the 15%, they matter, right? I'm not like a lot of you guys who fake care about the people who are left behind. I try to do something about it. And most of those people are going to be older people who just, you know, after 60, 70 years, their way of doing things is baked in. And I see the movement, but I don't see the outreach to try to bring people along. I'm not just saying that about First Caribbean, although I don't know what First Caribbean is doing to bring people along. But we've have a society where we have this level of digitization and communication without the sort of outreach to people who really need it to get along. And I know what you're saying. Well, your grandson's going to help you, or your niece, or somebody will help you too. But I think the least we could do is try to have a balance. I think you should allow certain transactions, maybe for people over a certain age, maybe for people who are at a level of disability, visually impaired, et cetera, et cetera. And I don't know that just moving faster than people can catch up is the ideal thing that we want to do. All right? And so we know, not everything we learned during the pandemic was a good thing, or not everything we did during the pandemic was a good thing. Closing schools was a disaster, as we now know. But at least closing schools to in-person learning is a disaster, and virtual learning is ineffective for the vast, vast, vast majority of developing minds. We have to strike a balance, and it concerns me that a lot of people who are under the poverty line are held. Forget about the poverty line. A lot of people who are not well-versed in banking and are unbanked, they're going to be impacted, and I don't want to see them left behind, because I think society should function for everyone, not just the majority, but everyone. And so, at least in terms of being able to have banking services, it's a critical part of functioning in a society. And so I think the answer is more outreach, more education, and, you know, we talk around it, and we don't do it, you know? Now, I have had experience with the First Caribbean ATMs, and they've like upgraded them all from what I can see over the past few months. And they do, you can go, what I used to do is I used to go to the Dropbox if I got a check, and I'd drop it in the Dropbox, and then they'd post it like that day. All right, and if it was from a clearing bank, it would go max 2 days if it was in the weekend, and you would see it like clear your account. Now, I've been to the Smart ATM, and they're impressive because you put a check in, it'll take a picture of your check and print it on your receipt for you so that you have evidence of a deposit and the actual check. All right? But it's not as efficient as the Dropbox. It's just not. And perhaps they'll work on that. It took me 7 days to clear a check when I put it in the ABM. And, you know, a lot of people can't wait that long. They can't wait for the kinks to work out. I have online banking at First Caribbean. All right. It's very convenient once you get it done. But you have to go through a lot of the KYC, et cetera, to get it set up. All right. And we're not all rubes who can't figure things out. But I'm just saying, I think that it's something that we could look at as a society. We still need to offer services that are for those who aren't up to speed on what's going on with the digital world, you know. And it's just it strikes me as something that we haven't been looking at for. Like, we don't. There are elderly people who need help, and we don't help them. We don't have systems set up with enough help for them, even though society does do some things and the government does do some things. There are people who are being left behind because they can't keep up. All right, and sometimes you gotta slow when someone's learning. right? You got to slow down and help them along, and then they could, then you could pick the pace back up. But I mean, and you're going to ask me, when's an ideal time? When do you do it? When's a perfect time? Nothing's perfect. I'm not saying anything should be. I'm saying that as a society, we owe it to people to help as much as we can. All right? That's what I'm saying. And so, and let's not fake talk about it. Like, I saw some talk on our Facebook page about the story with the singing bishop. And of course, you know, who am I to ask you to read a story before forming an opinion on the basis of what the story is actually about? I know that's a challenge for a lot of Bahamians. But they're like, why is it a story? And what are y'all doing? And leave the bishop alone. No one's bothering the bishop. There are charities in the United States who said they'd be giving the money back. The reporter knows the bishop, but even if she didn't, she can call him and ask him how he feels about that and if the FTX money was useful to him. If you read the story, you wouldn't sit there on your Facebook, and I try not to be too judgmental, but you kind of show me who you are as humans, right? So if you read the story, maybe you wouldn't be there on Facebook where you think the world exists, talking about leave the bishop alone. If you read the story, you'd hear how he said he's spending $10,000 in a week trying to feed people. He's feeding thousands of people. Why don't you get out of your phone screen? See, this is where the real world happens. Get out of your phone screen and go and help him feed these people, since you care so much to take your time to come on Facebook to condemn someone who knows him, highlighting how much he actually does. And that's the issue with a lot of people. We don't actually, we talk at it. Doing is a different matter around here. And I'm speaking to a lot of you right now, right? Because that's what you like to you talky, right? And I get it. I talk too for a living. The doing part is the part we need to do something about, right? Because what we do is we talk it out into the atmosphere and go, somebody got to do it, right? Now, it's somebody's job to do certain things, then they need to go do that. But if you're saying somebody should help, you could try to be a part of that. I'm going to go see the bishop this week and go bless him with something while you're all talking. I can't stop you from talking. But if you would complement that with some action, I think things might actually get better to me. Because I don't know how you read that story and walk away with anything other than this man is doing the Lord's work and I should feel compelled to help him because I had no idea there are so many people in Bain Town and elsewhere who have issues feeding themselves. They're food insecure, right? For whatever reason, I'm not going to judge you. If you're hungry and we're giving out food, come eat, right? You may live in a mansion and your cupboards are bare. It's not for me to judge, right? I'm too much on the tip of giving out money to panhandlers, but if we're having a kitchen and someone wants a meal, absolutely, come eat. Anyway, we'll do some of these text messages. Hey, Juan, I think SBF is here in the Bahamas for his own safety. Three crypto founders have died within a few months unexpectedly, one in a drowning, another in a helicopter accident, and the latest in his sleep. Go figure. Listen, it's difficult to get me on a plane. You're not going to get me in a helicopter. I've read too many stories of famous people dying in helicopter, not famous, rich people dying in helicopter accidents. Says, yes, tell them. They just talk and talk and talking. Help feed these people is correct. Tell them. No, you want to sit on social media and demonstrate your what? Ability to condemn a newspaper? Are you dumb? Do you know how many times we've highlighted the work that Bishop Roald does? How many times he's asked for help through all of the media platforms that we have and we've gotten him help? It's look to your own lack of action and impetus. But and try to remove yourself from the comfort zone you have where you just judge and don't actually look to do anything. Because I just see you talking. Juan, it's okay to start your show on time. Sometimes, you know. Yep, I can't knock you. I can't fight you. I didn't start on time. That's my bad. I couldn't control all the circumstances, but it is what it is. Great show as usual. How do you make it on Village Road? Prayer. Sometimes whiskey, right? At night on Village Road. You can if you sit and think about it, you'll be angry every day. Every day I drop my children to school. We can walk there, but the road's no longer safe to walk on. All right, and it's a wreck. Like it's all muddy. But you drive there, and it's a nightmare every single day. Every single day, and it's angering, and there's such a thing as people's patience running out. Says that line for the bank by Kelly's ain't playing most days though. Well, I do a lot of stuff at Harbor Bay, and there's always a line. Says hi Juan. Note the tone of the memo. Very dictatorial. The board of directors of this bank should be fired. Fire the board. Goodness, the country's not ready for this. I wish the Prime Minister would invite Bank of America to open up here. Too fast, too much. I hope they lose customers. Like crazy, they've lost me. No, I'm not saying they should lose customers at all. I know people who work at First Caribbean. I don't want anyone to lose customers or lose their livelihood. And I'm very satisfied with the service. So I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is it highlights that maybe we're moving in this direction for whatever reason. I'm sure there's profit-driven reasons in First Caribbean. But maybe we're moving in this direction so fast before we can actually catch everybody else up. And I'm not saying it's First Caribbean's job to educate people who may be left behind. What I'm saying is that we should figure out how we're getting to these people. There's agencies, there are programs that we can have that we can look at to design. I'm willing to help as much as I can in public education with it. That's what I'm saying. Says the First Caribbean notices another instance of old people being marginalized. My parents in their 70s and their siblings are so stressed now because of these changes. As people get older, they naturally slow down. Dealing with computers only, including ATMs, is not fair to them. Yeah. It's very, you know, old people are set in their ways. Like my mom, before she died, you know, she was always like, I got to go verify to get my national insurance money, you know, because if she didn't get this $375 a month from the government, she was highly upset, you know, and so I got to go verify. And then when they started closing the thing, you know, well, she had started declining because of her dementia, but when they said you don't have to come verify for NIB, she didn't even understand what I was talking about. See, like, how do you mean? And, no, I gotta go verify. You know what I mean? And I just sit there and tell her, well, they're closed. So this, you know what I mean? So naturally, some people adjust or take longer to adjust. This says, do you know what this means for someone who has to cash a check at month end and pay the same day? It means, especially if COVID has put you behind on payments, and this statement about clients willingly moving to digital is nonsense. It's not just older people. Think about someone like a construction worker. Think of someone who can't read. I don't know who's spearheading digitization at these companies, but they literally know nothing about their customers. And this is not just banks. This is not what digitization, it says nothing about customers and very little knowledge about what digitization is supposed to achieve. Digitization, cashless, mobile wallets, and crypto are just sexy terms for people who know nothing about technology and adoption to throw around. Listen, I like the digital banking services. And if I were like a lot of other people, I'd be like, hell, I'm happy. I'm good. I'm well fed. Screw everybody else, right? I'm tight with the bank, with the digital bank, and it works out great for me. But I have the capacity. I don't know if it's just a trait that few of us maybe possess, or I'm not rating humanity out here. I have the capacity to think beyond my own personal satisfaction and needs. Since I'm beginning to believe that Sam Bankman-Fried was told by some officials to avoid questions from the local media. He's taking interviews from media from other countries, except the country where his institution is based. Yeah, and the frustrating part about that is y'all are coming to the Bahamas, y'all are talking to him while he's in the Bahamas, but you're not saying anything about the Bahamas that we want to know. A couple of things. But you're not, and we here in the Bahamas, SBF, who you want to make happy, we got questions about what's going on in the Bahamas. Now, you may not be inclined to answer those questions, but we have questions. Says, hi, Juan. The bank is assuming that elderly people have someone that won't rip them off. Not everyone has trustworthy family. True, too. This says, hey, one great show as usual. I'm a customer of a bank who recently transitioned to the smart ABM. 65% of the time, these ABMs don't take the deposit, and this difficulty is coming from someone who hasn't been in a bank in 2 years. Make sure the system works before cutting the alternatives. Yeah, the digital banking service at First Caribbean works well for me. My check took longer to clear than it normally would, having gone in the bank, and it was from a clearing bank. But I guess that's just part of the process they're working out. I'm trying to move to a space where I do all digital transactions. So that's just me. It says, I have to traverse Village Road daily. I feel your pain, Juan. Yeah, it's progress and they're fixing the road. But my God, man, it's a wreck. We got to go to, are we coming back or we just got to go? We go straight to news? All right, well, give me 2 moments. It says, Juan, Bank of America takes deposits, cash, and checks every day. They also cash checks and encourage you to open a checking account. Yeah. It says, great shows usual. Are you doing a toy drive this Christmas? I'm not doing a toy drive this Christmas, but if you have someone you want to give to or you want to, I could maybe facilitate if you wanted to help someone. Juan, I'm 100% sure it takes more than praise, and also I'm 1,000% sure you'll need a new car driving on that road. I give it 15 more road trips. I've already had like 4 flat tires. You know, and they're not cheap. You know, and it's inconvenient. You're dealing with people's lives. It's not, you know, it's not a game. All right, people, they're trying to live, and it's difficult. Okay. We're going to break right now. It says, Juan, all of the banks that are pushing these cost-cutting measures are foreign banks. The Bahamians have real good alternatives in terms of banking. Change your bank, diversify your portfolio. Bank with at least 4 banks. Doesn't matter what balance you have. Keep and use multiple options. I bank with all 3 Bahamian banks and 1 Caribbean Canadian bank. When one frustrates me, I move my money. I fully utilize digital banking and never go into a bank. But for those that do, you're a consumer. Stop letting the banks treat you guys like garbage. Move your funds and they will feel it where it counts. It's not like BPL and you have no alternatives. Use your alternative. Yeah. And I don't say any of that to cause a problem for First Caribbean. It just speaks to something in the country. All right. That we're moving very fast with this, but are we making sure to look behind us to see that people aren't being left behind? Says, Juan, just tell SBF you're mad at him, since that matters to him. Everybody gives Juan or Paige the exclusive instead of George Stephanopoulos. I ain't even tripping off no exclusive, you know. Go get your interview. But I'm saying we still got questions. And I'm be real with you. I'd be pretty selective about who from over here I'd be given an interview to, because I've seen a lot of the reporting on FTX, and it needs work. Let's go to a break. We'll be right back.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
I used to think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem, just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
Okay, class, let's begin today's history lesson. Ancient civilization used to visit stadiums to watch musicians perform. It was called a live concert.
Teacher, what year was that?
Researchers believe it was around 2019. Normal life feels like a long time ago. As things return to normal, remember, it is essential to be fully immunized against all vaccine-preventable diseases like COVID-19, rubella, polio, hepatitis, mumps, and influenza. This message is brought to you by PAHO WHO, the Ministry of Health and Wellness, the Caribbean Development Bank, the Government of Canada, and the United States of America.
Burger King wants you to ride into the holidays in style with a brand new 2022 BYD Han all-electric sedan from Easy Car Sales. It's as easy as 1, 2, 3. Just upgrade your favorite combo for one ticket, or double your chances with the King Combo, or triple your chance to win with the purchase of a BK Family Deal. It's electric at Burger King this holiday, where you get the chance to win a 2022 BYD Han EV sedan when you upgrade your combo at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
You do coffee your way.
Double shot, decaf, cappuccino.
Light roast, Colombian, no milk.
You do vacations your way.
Hiking boots, tent, mountains.
Five-star hotels and theater.
And now you can do insurance your way.
Online.
Email.
Chat.
WhatsApp.
Or in branch. For home, car, travel, boat, or business insurance, do it anyway with NUA Insurance agents and brokers. Visit NUAinsurance.com, call, or stop by a branch today.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
We know how important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options. We're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators and generators back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Wait, you know what's going down tomorrow?
Nobody, what happening?
Joe bringing the knife to school? He could do Junior in?
For what?
Wait, he fool with Joe girl?
Mother sick. And you know Junior don't bark down for nothing. So that means he got a big fight tomorrow.
So whose side you on?
Side? I trying to stay in school, not Simpson fan. We gotta tell somebody about this fight.
Tell somebody? I ain't no snitch. I mean cool, you know.
Wait, if you so cool, then you need to stay in school and stay out of the fight.
Yeah, but if I don't hang on Joe's side, him and he boys coming for me next.
Alright, so we definitely gotta tell somebody. We gotta prevent the fight.
What I say, I don't want nobody call me snitch.
We could just call Crime Stoppers. You could report what you know, and nobody gotta know it's you.
So how do I work?
All you gotta do is call them, or you text them through the Crack Crime Bahamas app, and nobody can know it's you.
Then the police come looking for me for more info, and when they finish with them, Joe them coming looking for me?
When you call Crime Stoppers, the calls go directly to Miami, and they don't ask nothing about you. Then if you get the pen from them, and they can claim a reward later using that same pen.
Plus, everything's scrambled, so nobody can read what you said.
Calls 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
One in every four people in the Bahamas face some level of food insecurity. Through our annual Feed 5000 program, AML Foods remains steadfast in our commitment to help those struggling with hunger and will donate 5,000 to provide holiday meals to families this Christmas. But we need your help. From November 14th to December 19th, show your support and donate at the register at any Solomon's, Costrite, Solomon's Fresh Market, Exuma Markets, or Domino's locations in New Providence, Grand Bahama, and Exuma. Together, let's put an end to hunger.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. We'll be right back.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. My name's Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. Okay, so recently we were talking about COP27 and the Bahamas, you know, wagging a finger at other nations who were contributing to climate change, pollution, etc. And I started to explain how I think that that's all well and good, but if we don't practice what we preach here, then the world just simply won't take us seriously or won't believe us when we seem to have made some headway so far. And when I was talking about that, I gave the example of the cruise ship companies, who I'm not against cruise ships, you know. I think they play a critical role in the economy, but I do think that continuing to deepen the relationship with them in certain respects doesn't make sense. And I gave the example of Royal Caribbean, how they want their cake and eat it too. They want to bring their cruise passengers and then take their cruise passengers to their own private club on Paradise Island when they already have their own private key that they take their cruise ship passengers to. And I don't think it makes a lot of sense. And I don't like deepening that relationship to that extent. I want the cruise ships to come. It's just that I don't know how much more I want these companies invested in our economy. And to that end, I thought about Toby Smith, who's been battling with Royal Caribbean over some space on Paradise Island. And I wanted him to explain in more detail the issue and kind of give us an update on where we are. Because what I do understand is that Royal Caribbean's last proposal was rejected. The misadministration had stalled on it. And the Progressive Liberal Party, when it came to power, it rejected the previous proposal. I think you would have heard Chester Cooper saying that, but I understand that Royal Caribbean has now put up another proposal into the government and is trying to get approval to operate their private beach club on Paradise Island. And I'm not an anti-commerce guy. I'm just like, if we're going to have some place where tourists are going to go, I'm all for making more Bahamian ownership. All right? I appreciate that they want to create Bahamian jobs. But if we got Bahamian ownership who's interested in it now, that's funded, that has a business plan, that actually has a lease with the government, I'd rather see the Bahamian get it. That's just me. Or at least, hell, like, not Royal Caribbean. I just say it on there, Rod. I thought Dwight spoken with the president. Then I got. I just say. I just like, man, y'all. You know, come on. What all y'all want? Like a private key, the shipyard, the what else? The Freeport Harbor, huh? Yeah, the Grand Lucan, exactly, what all y'all want. So, Toby, welcome back.
Thank you very much for having me, Juan. Good afternoon, Bahamas, and throughout the world.
So help me understand what you understand about what's going on right now with this Paradise Island issue. You'd taken the court, and that's still...
Right, so I was offered a lease by ex-Prime Minister Minnis. I accepted that lease. They then told me that it wasn't written the paper it was written on. So I then had no other choice but to seek the assistance of the courts. That hearing has now gone through the full process, and now we are patiently waiting for a decision to come from the Chief Justice, Ian Winder, from the Supreme Court, to rule that my, hopefully, from my perspective, to hopefully say that the lease is valid and that the government has to honor the lease. Mm-hmm. So where I'm at is waiting on a decision. And yes, I have also heard that Royal Caribbean is wooing the government through their regular, you know, meals and whatnot, in trying to woo the government into doing a deal with them for Bahamian Crown land on Paradise Island, when they already know, because I've sent them my site plan of exactly where my lease Crown land is on Paradise Island.
So, help me understand why the two operations can't coexist, if that had to happen. Simply
because the Crown land that's included through a recorded legal site plan and approved by Lands and Surveys that delineates the exact dimensions of the two parcels of Crown land that were granted in my lease, that it was double-dipped by ex-Prime Minister Minnis, and RCL are basically running over my beach parcel, which is 3 acres, by about 2.85 acres. Mm. So it just leaves me what they think is just a little piece in the corner, right, which is not acceptable to me.
Yeah.
So why can't we coexist? Because they're trying to pillage...
Have the whole hog.
Have the whole hog of Hog Island, ironically. Right. But they're trying to pillage over my boundaries. And I told them very diplomatically, and I sent them a copy of my site plan, to say this is where my parcel exists on the beach. And then they announced that they signed a lease with the government. I said, well, then show me your site plan. They literally sent me my site plan back with some pink highlighter on it, right, to say that this is our parcel right here.
All of this is us.
Yeah,
and then over here, you in the corner.
That's you.
So they want to set up their $50 million operation outfit, and you're gonna have a Kung salad stand,
right?
Over here in the back, kind of.
Right. But the interesting part is that in the Royal Caribbean Cruise Lines lease with the then Minnis government, they do not have a site plan included in their lease, which is a legal requirement. They don't also have a legal description of the land, which should describe the boundaries. So from a fundamental perspective, in looking at RCL's lease that this multi-billion international, multinational company has signed, I, in layman's terms, could pull it apart, and I'm not even a lawyer. So if they want to force the issue, and we go down the route of people asking me about judicial reviews and stuff, then, all right, let's start doing an audit and let's start doing a judicial review of what's going on.
Right.
I have nothing to hide. I've done it the transparent, honest way. And as a Bahamian, I believe that I should be afforded the opportunity of audience to be heard out.
Absolutely. So what are you hearing from, like, the current administration? Because they had seemed like shut RCL down completely when they first came to power. But I do hear they're mulling over something new. You haven't heard anything? You can't speak on it? All right.
It's not that I can't speak, but I'm not going to speak for what the government, what the government's position is.
Right.
I believe that what I was told by the government, that I prefer to give them the opportunity to mull over what they said to me in case they need to somehow change what they've said in different circumstances. So I'm not going to share with what government told me. It was a very brief meeting, but I believe as a all Bahamian owned and operated project, looking at the track record of Royal Caribbean Cruise Line and frankly other cruise lines also, but look at Coco Key. They RCL brag of coming to the Bahamas for 50 years. Where's the head office downtown? It doesn't exist. They have lawyers in town. That's pretty much about it. Mm-hmm. Why is it that if a passenger in Coco Key wishes to book a jet ski for $150, for instance, that 80 of those dollars goes to Royal Caribbean? Unless you're on board with the program of promotion with Royal Caribbean, then they're not promoting it. So the revenues that Royal Caribbean generate go directly out of the country to their corporate office, their big bonuses that their bosses get, to their shareholders. Bahamians can't buy shares in it. Bahamians can't get dividends from it. So we're exploited through our human resources that they don't want. I'll even go so far as saying that, you know, there's racial segregation. There's cultural segregation. Why do they not want black Bahamian workers serving their guests on Coco Key? Why is it that they're pulling off Indians and Filipinos that don't contribute towards national insurance, don't have work permits, because of some treaty or whatever, where Bahamians are stuck cleaning toilets and picking up garbage? And those are important jobs, I agree. But my project, on the other hand, will retain those earnings in the Bahamas. They will only employ Bahamians. It will have knock-on effect to other jobs where I will be buying from local wholesalers for food, whereas RCL import off of the ship all of their food that they're power buying in the States and other places around the world. So I think it's a great opportunity for this project in particular to be able to show the world of what Bahamians can do when they're allowed to be able to operate and in full effect.
Yeah, and I want to talk about your operation, but I think in essence, part of me is just has a reaction as a nationalist when you tell me, okay, so you have a private island here, and that's fine. You say there's some weird stuff
and
going
that's
on.
Crown land now. Don't forget, Coco Key is Crown land.
Correct.
Yeah,
and I've seen what you've done with it. It looks wonderful. I won't lie to you. And you also bring your ships to the port of Nassau. Now you want your passengers, the second they touch dry land at Nassau Harbor, they go get on ferries and go direct to your private operation, starving dollars from the downtown merchants, et cetera, the merchants at Junkanoo Beach and all this other stuff like that. And part of me, the nationalist part, just goes, you know what? No.
You don't fly.
Yeah.
So incidentally, when RCL were applying to the Department of Environmental Planning and Protection, they hosted a conference call where it was mainly them promoting themselves and bringing out these all, you know, millions and billions of numbers. But they never really spoke specifically as far as cruise passenger spending is concerned of how much ends up in Bahamians' pockets, number one. But they also made preposterous allegations, such as if there was an emergency on Paradise Island at their proposed beach club, then they would drive in an ambulance the person to the hospital. Mm-hmm. Well, they needed a bit of a reality check that the road stops at Atlantis and there is no road to drive an ambulance to the hospital. They also made note, how you saying, of the passengers getting off the ship, going to the cruise port. In their presentation, they labeled Wood Rogers Wharf as Bay Street and saying that people would be walking Bay Street. Mm. Well, if Royal Caribbean have demonstrated and illustrated that they don't actually know where Bay Street is, how can we expect any revenues to make it to Bay Street?
Yeah.
But that was actually an untruth, because where they've redesigned the port, Bahamians used to have approximately 1,200 feet along Woods Rogers Wharf, and that's now down to about 200 feet of public access to Woods Rogers Wharf. And they're not walking all the way down there anyway. The ferry boats that used to pick up there are now going to be located by the cruise port pickup area on the eastern side of Prince George Wharf.
Right.
So the tourists will come straight off the ship. They're not even making it to the cruise port center yet. They're actually getting picked up on the dock and getting picked up and dropped off right there on the dock. So forget about anything coming down to Bay Street.
If they were, see, and here's the thing. If you were telling me, like, it's on a different island that needs the business or whatever like that, we could talk, we could have that discussion. But you don't need to send your people to Paradise Island. We already have operations on Paradise Island that the cruise ship visitors can go to.
Yeah.
And they traverse downtown. They use the taxi drivers. Some are madmen and will walk over that bridge. But we already have an operation. We already have operations that benefit Bahamians. And I
benefit
don't think
Bahamians.
They
there you go.
More.
Think about
plus,
this.
Let me just say, you have an operation like a Disney, right?
Mm-hmm.
Disney, the head of Disney Cruise Lines came here to me and explained like all of the things they do and the goodwill they have. And one of the things I found palatable about Disney, even though I'm under no illusions that it's not a huge major conglomerate that's into, you know, corporate
making money
overlordship, right? What I found interesting about them is Disney never took part in the rebate program. All right. So, you know, RCL did, Carnival did, a couple other ones.
That's commendable.
They never took part in the rebate program, but all these other guys have. Right.
Right.
And
so don't get me
they're
wrong.
Going to a Luthra. You don't need to go to PI.
Don't
I don't
get me
think
wrong.
So.
They're not. So if it's the right business model that works for Bahamians, then don't get me wrong. I'm not opposed to it. Right. However, when you see five cruise ships sitting at Prince George Wharf and two of those are chugging out high sulfur fuel oil smoke, then what are the other three doing that the other two aren't, right? And what is the common denominator is that it's always the RCL, the Wonder of the Seas, the this, the that, that are all chugging out this heavy, high sulfur fuel oil smoke, whereas Disney switching over to run LP or diesel, which is more expensive, right? But I don't know if you've noticed or not, but you remember back in the day when cruise ships used to come to Nassau, they weren't allowed to open their casinos while in port.
Mm-hmm.
Right. There used to be a whole bunch of liquor stores on Bay Street.
Mm-hmm.
There ain't too many liquor stores on Bay Street no more because passengers aren't allowed to buy liquor and bring it on board for them to consume in their cabins anymore.
Mm-hmm.
They have to give it when they board the ship and they can get it. It's put into a locker and when they depart the ship and disembark, then they can get their liquor back. So let's wipe out any crew or most cruise ship spending for liquor stores downtown. Let's just take that off the table to begin with. Let's take off the table that if anybody wants to book an excursion, they either book it through, for instance, RCL, who skim 50, 60, 70, 80% off of the top, so that the Bahamian guys are fighting over the same piece of the pie, which is smaller, but they take on the liability insurance of what they have to have, which is very high, what the cruise ship demand. They have to comp if anybody has any kind of complaint. They have all of the work to do, and RCL don't do the work but want to collect an extortionate amount of what the total revenues are.
Mm-hmm.
So you think of the commodity of a beach and how many beaches are in Nassau. How many Bahamians can actually have access to a beach, number one, let alone a beach with a bathroom, number two? Name me a beach in Nassau that has a bathroom with it.
It's the and Paradise Island. It's the most expensive real estate, you know, in Nassau or Paradise Island.
So this
it's
is the only crown. This is the only crown land left on PI, right? And Minnis, in his ultimate ignorance, wanted to give the prime, only beach, only crown land left on Paradise Island to RCL for a minimum of 150 years, which is, there's absolutely something wrong with that. Meanwhile, I have a cabinet conclusion for designating it. I would venture to, I would like to ask, does RCL's lease approval, is it coupled with the cabinet conclusion? Because I've been told that they didn't.
Mm.
So that was just a decision by one person that was made to draw them up a lease. So, I mean, maybe they do have a cabinet conclusion, but in me having talks with them, and this is going back a couple of years, when they asked me to send me their site plan, they basically tried to dupe me in saying, Toby, you have a site plan? Give us a copy of your site plan so we can have a look and see how our development would work with a reduced footprint that doesn't encroach upon your boundaries.
Oh, that sounds good.
Well, then a few days later, they said, forget about it. We've already signed a lease, right? We don't need your site plan, and we don't need you. You go deal with the government, because we straight. Forget about it, right? Yeah. So I said, all right, since you signed a lease, send me your site plan. And that's when they sent me my site plan back with all this highlighter on it.
Yeah, I agree. We do need foreign direct investment. We need development, but not at the expense of Bahamian ownership. You know, we gotta actually, you know, draw a line in the sand on.
So foreign direct investment is one thing, and I agree with you. We do need to have foreign direct investment, and unfortunately, most of that foreign direct investment allows for the host country to just see all those revenues go out of the country, right? But when there aren't Bahamian direct investments being approved, then it's only foreign direct investment projects that are going on. So Carnival in Grand Bahama for their own private port. You've got about 10 different keys in the Bahamas where the cruise ships have their own private ports. So when is it going to be Bahamian owned? My project is 100% Bahamian owned, whereas the foreign owned projects, not only are they exporting the money out the country, but Bahamian projects aren't getting approved. Yeah. So I've seen the point go from a parking lot to a full-on operation with Margaritaville. I've seen Bahama come out the ground in the 11 years that I've been trying, go bankrupt, start again, get complete, get open. The Warwick change hands to the Chinese owner. Now Hurricane Hall, foreign-owned, opened up, all going on. So think how many Bahamian-owned projects are we seeing that are getting approved and allow us to have a sustainable development that employs Bahamians and showcase Bahamian culture?
Yeah, what I found, and your case, why I support you, because I found it insidious that you had been taking care of the lighthouse on your own, prompted by no one, at your own expense.
Yeah.
You were fixing up out there. Nobody was checking for it.
Yeah.
You finally got your dream together and got your approval for it. And then all of a sudden, RCL comes and go, we want that.
Yeah.
And they're going to just yank it from a Bahamian who's cared about it and has treasured it and highlighted it because you were going out there. From before, they're just going to yank it from a Bahamian
and
go, give it to y'all. If y'all go buy the, what is it? We were going to give them the Grand Lucayan Hotel. I'm sorry, not give. We were going to pay them to buy the Grand Lucayan Hotel.
Where the Bahamians are going to fund them.
Bahamians are going to fund them.
And to then wait until late next decade.
Now, 10 years before they could do development.
No, before we start getting paid back.
Right. Oh, right.
And so Bahamians are now now Bahamians are financing this multi-billion-dollar company.
Exactly. And so the trade-off was go ahead and give them the beachfront crown land too.
Yeah.
And because no one was checking for it, they gave it to you.
Yeah.
And as soon as the big guys come and they want to do business with the government, they just yank it from you.
Six weeks later.
Something's fundamentally wrong with that.
6 weeks later, Minister decided, you know what? Let's just forget about Toby. Carl Bethel was all up in that. Let's just swing Toby out of this and give it all to RCL and let Toby make noise about it. All right, you know what? Well, you messed with the wrong dude because I ain't giving up and I haven't given up.
Yeah,
and I know plenty of Bahamians support it.
Says Toby, you can't speak. Then it sounds like don't be surprised if I get swing. Promises, promises again. Oh, you mean about your talks with the government?
Oh, you know, I still got confidence in the government. There's nothing wrong with having dialogue. There's nothing wrong with having open communications. Unfortunately, right now in the news, it seems as though the government is rather occupied with, you know, getting FTX here. And now, you know, getting FTX with the bankruptcy that came along with it. So, again, Bahamians, back of the line, roll out the red carpet treatment for the foreigners and slap some red tape in there for Bahamians. This is an excellent opportunity for the now government to have some redemption towards Bahamians and say, look, we just approved Toby. Instead of Toby having to wait on a court decision, Toby's ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
Let him do it. If he falls over on his face, all right, well, we gave him the opportunity, he fell over.
Right.
I haven't fallen over yet, man. I'm gonna say how old I am, but I haven't fallen over yet.
Yeah, absolutely. But I want to talk. We're gonna take a break, and then I want to talk a bit about what you have planned out there, and see how that's gonna benefit us all.
Thank you.
Right? Let's take a break, and we'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. Another wave is coming, but this time it's a tropical heat wave. Marco's Pizza is bringing you two new wing flavors, guaranteed to spice up your summer. Just wing it and indulge in our Jamaican jerk and mango habanero flavors. 10 pieces boneless wings for only $13.75 and bone in for only $16.15. We are bringing you the heat all summer long. Try our new Jamaican jerk or mango habanero wings today. Make every day a wing day. Marco's Pizza, every store, every day, the Italian way.
Here we go.
J.S. Johnson Insurance agents are the best. Reliable service, you've been on the scene, protecting since 1919. J.S. Johnson Insurance has the best. Always, you're always calling me.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
This is Guardian Radio 9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
The holidays are a time for reflection on the year past, reconnecting with family and friends, and indulging in brand new experiences. No matter what your holiday may bring, at Reb, we remind you to do it together. Play together. Watch together. Be together. Take time to connect with the people and things that really matter. And let Rev take care of home for the holidays. Merry Christmas, Bahamas!
You do coffee your way.
Double shot, decaf, cappuccino.
Light roast, Colombian, no milk.
You do vacations your way.
Hiking boots, tent, mountains.
Five-star hotels and theater.
And now you can do insurance your way.
Online.
Email.
Chat.
WhatsApp.
Or in branch. For home, car, travel, boat, or business insurance, do it anyway with NUA Insurance agents and brokers. Visit NUAinsurance.com or stop by a branch today.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
I used to think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem, just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. I'm sitting here with Toby Smith. Toby's been planning a project out at Paradise Island on the last parcel of Crown land out there. He had a lease. He had a site plan. He had a cabinet conclusion. All was good to go. Royal Caribbean swooped in and essentially tried to just yank it away from him. And the government has been, the previous administration, let me say, has been complicit in it. And now this administration has had rejected that plan. And now there's another plan put forward. I haven't had sight of it yet, so I don't know exactly what it entails or how different it will be from before. But I'm backing Toby on this one. I don't like it. I don't like what they did to you. So
thank you, Juan. I appreciate the support.
We got to try at least. I mean, you got to put up a fight, right?
Yeah.
So if you can, here's the thing. If you're going to kill me, it could be a fight, right? I ain't just going to lay down.
No, I laying down. And I appreciate your support, Juan. And I tell you, there's a lot of people out there that support. I wouldn't say support me. I would say that support me in what I'm trying to do out there in bringing this project to fruition. And all right. I appreciate you, Bahamians, and people around the world for your support.
Okay, this is, yep, and they're still closing the eastern entrance for Cabbage Beach every weekend. Reason they gave was too much fighting. Come on, ain't none of these young guys going to fight with cold water and 70-degree windy beach in the winter. Do they still do that?
I don't go over there.
No, I didn't either.
Right? Ain't allowed.
It says Toby needs this project just because of his commitment in the face of opposition. We really can't share in the dividends of our foreign partners, and in addition to that, their ships are really a destination in and of themselves. I'm like, it's a limit. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but if you could get to that limit and keep on chewing more and taking, take, they could keep taking.
It's a limit. We need a $50 million beach club on. No, you don't. No, you don't.
Yeah.
You know? No, you don't.
Yeah.
This says, Mr. Mac, Toby should be granted that land. He's done a lot for the Bahamas and has done work for the government. I'm a government worker saying this. Yeah, Toby be doing nice things for y'all, like the flamingo out there by the Gladstone Road roundabout.
Right. I sculpted that in my driveway with my daughter. Just big up Bianca. And yeah, I did that.
Let me help you, because I lived through the New Providence Road Improvement Project. And I'm now living through the Village Road Improvement Project.
Oh, Lord.
They're about to do Gladstone Road, and they're about to redo that roundabout. You best make sure your flamingo is in a safe place before they go
through. That's Ringo the Flamingo, man. He's going to jam out there. Don't worry. He good. He got secrets and mysteries that no one knows about except me and Bianca.
There you go.
He survived two hurricanes.
That's true. Yeah, right.
I put new legs on them. They bent. The hurricanes bent them over. But yeah, one thing that I try not to do is really promote the charities that I do. Mm-hmm. So I do a lot of it behind closed doors. I do a lot of it. It could just be buying somebody breakfast because they look hungry, or it could be helping like a feeding network or something like that. Whereas others want a photograph and in the newspapers for every little thing that they do. So behind the scenes, I mean, even if it's, you know, buying a kid a pair of school shoes or something like that, I do give a lot back to the community. And I will say this, is that if you expect a lot out of your workers, and people do expect a lot out of your workers, the onus is on you is to, number one, train those workers, but two, man, reward them. I've never paid any of my workers minimum wage, ever, right? When they get a bonus at the end of the year, they could buy a car with that, right? And I want them to do well. One of my workers, they were threatening to amputate one of his daughter's legs. I'm like, man, go be with your family, and here's something to help with your daughter, right? And then because of that, we started a catastrophe fund. Great. So the other guys that were with me, we call each other brothers. So my other brothers, we make sure that if somebody is going through hardship, that we all go behind them and support them with that.
Right.
And this project would be no different.
So let me, before we talk about what the project entails, I'll play devil's advocate for a moment.
Cool.
Like I, you know. Royal Caribbean's got access to tens of millions of dollars in financing, not to buy our hotel. But, they're going to build a $50 million club. They're going to make that investment. How Toby could match that?
I'm not going to attempt to match that. But imagine this, right? If they go and build a $50 million beach club and they go and export 80% of that, then they're leaving $1 million in the Bahamas to go around for everybody. So what's better, a $50 million beach club that leaves $1 million, or a $5 million beach club that generates, let's say, $5 million a year, And 99% of that after the build, right? Because you've got to import stuff to build it out in the first place. But 99% of that remains in the Bahamas, in the Bahamian banks, in the Bahamian workers. That those revenues that come into it circulate through Bahamian pockets many, many times over. So right. You've got that $5 million that's circulating 10 times, that's now $50 million that until people export it by going across to Miami shopping or importing something from Amazon or something like that, but those dollars stay in the Bahamas.
Right.
And that's my biggest point. So yeah, they could be touting all these numbers. Oh, we're going to have 15 trillion people coming in. How much money ends up in the Bahamas as a litmus test? Go downtown and see what a dump it is. Because if there was so much money coming into downtown, that place would be looking like Monaco, a Bahamian Monaco, right?
Correct.
It'd be looking Bahamian pristine, and that's what I'm offering. It's going to be Bahamian architecture, not, you know, funky cabanas and red umbrellas on the plastic umbrellas and stuff. It's going to be, it'll look like a Hopetown architecture, Harbor Island architecture, old Bahamian or ornate gingerbread houses. As the stores, there'll be a bar and grill, etc. But we're going to start and we're going to grow organically. There's nothing wrong with organic growth. You're going to invest where you see that there's the opportunity and heighten revenues.
That's my point. It's like, let him have it. Let's see what he could do with it. You know,
right?
So, cribbit track, man. Come on. If you don't give Bahamian, here's what I hate. Right? Why I gotta fight a foreigner?
Right.
Over Bahamian land.
Right.
That you told me I could lease, and you told me everything was fine. I approved it.
Yeah.
Now a foreigner come in who already have all this. Yeah. I gotta fight him.
I gotta right. So I'm not fighting RCL. I'm not interested whatsoever in suing them or getting into a court case with RCL. That's for the government to unwind with RCL, what their relationship is for the lease over there. That's on them. But for what my product is to have a safe atmosphere for Bahamians to have access to our only Crown Land beach on Paradise Island, where we're limited as far as the amount of beach access that we have in the Bahamas, to be able to go over and enjoy a safe environment and be able to have a Bahamian beer, a nice burger, relax on the beach, and then promote things like having Sea Scouts where kids can learn how to tie knots and tie a fishing hook and learn how to fish and learn how to swim. If 80% of the kids in the Bahamas don't know how to swim, then let's get on board with that. Beach safety and all these other ancillary things that come in for the better product of Bahamians. A politician is going to dictate to us when we can use the beach, when we can't use the beach. And RCL are saying, oh, we're going to figure out a special rate for Bahamians. Mm. Bahamians are going to have to pay a foreign company for us to be able to use our own Crown Land beach.
Yeah, it makes no sense. I'm totally on board with you, Toby.
Thank you.
It says, perhaps lawyers should not be allowed into anything in this country. Toby must be supported, if only for what his efforts will mean.
Amen.
For future Bahamians. Yeah, it's the right principle. On. It's a principle for me.
It is the principle, and hopefully this will be a catalyst for other Bahamians.
Right. It's the principle. Like I don't support that. If they had had it right, and then you were like, now I want it, I'd have been like, look, fair is fair. They were there first.
No problem.
But that don't seem to apply to you, right? So you got there first.
Definitely not.
You wanted it, and now.
I got it in writing. I know that I was approved on. I was given the letter of approval on the 7th of January, and I know that a letter went to them because it was in the public file. That it was given to them in February, just 6 weeks later.
Right.
So let's not beat around the bush as far as culpability is concerned. RCL know that I was granted it first, and even still, they're hiding behind that veil and schmoozing with government.
Yeah, I'm totally against them getting it. I really am. I think that just it's such a bad look.
It does. It is. And you, a multinational, multi-billion-dollar company that are doing this kind of nefarious affairs. I mean, look at Haiti.
It'd be one thing, but you actually had permission. You had business plan.
Yeah, man, I got the whole nine yards. That was by the time I got the lease, I'd been trying for 8 years of begging. I started on April 12th, 2012. So Hubert Ingram was just on his way out in May. I've been through the ending part of Hubert Ingram, all the way through Perry Christie, all the way through Hubert Minnis, and now I'm at 14 months into the PLP administration currently.
Mm.
I've been through all of that, And if I had started 11 years ago with a reasonable investment of $2 to $5 million, I know I could have grown that to the $50 million that RCL are talking about now.
Yeah, because if you got something nice set up, people will come. This says certain Bahamians, some in government, don't like when Bahamians rise. They rather
That's right.
The foreigners.
That's
well,
right.
See, the thing is this, too, though. And I try to, when people go, well, the foreigner, right? And the government, the foreigners. And I try to explain to them there's a balance needed. And
a we fair don't balance.
Be mean to foreigners. But then when you look at a situation like this and you go, are you being serious right now? Like a Bahamian, you gave the lease to and then someone else came and you're going to cut them out of it?
Right.
Like, a foreign company, and we're supposed to now say that, well, y'all aren't more interested in the foreigners than the Bahamians? It doesn't make any sense.
So on the flip side of that, wouldn't it be great if the government were to say, look, we're going to give this Bahamian the opportunity.
Right.
We want you to support. We're throwing our support behind him, and no, we're defending it. And what's ironic is that when you look at those that are in the media, that were in the media also under the Minnis administration, and what came out and what was said. Mm-hmm. So politicians saying that they will cancel any lease with RCL. I haven't actually seen them publicly come out and say that they canceled the lease with RCL. When a minister stands up and names me in Parliament, Toby Smith, a young Bahamian, an entrepreneur, right, where they support me. I need to see that support. Mm-hmm. Not when you're in opposition, but through meaningful ways, of tangible ways.
It says, I stand with Toby, my fellow Bahamian, tired of Bahamians playing second fiddle to rich foreign companies.
Fiddle? They won't charge us VAT on the fiddle. You go to register if you want a fiddle. And then only licenses for fiddles are given out to their boys. Fiddle act.
It says, how did your guests get such prime crown land in just 10 years? Some Bahamians have had applications in for crown land for decades and have gotten nothing.
Okay, so can I answer that?
Sure.
I applied. I applied, and you hear me now. I am backing down. And I have been rattling the cage, and the squeaky door gets the oil. So I'd encourage any Bahamian that wants to apply for Crown Land, go to Bay and Armstrong Street, go to the Lands and Survey Office, put in your application, make sure you keep a copy of your application, have somebody sign that they received your application, and write to them every month, and be relentless in your pursuit. They got 35,000 was the last count, 35,000 applications for Crown Land, sitting there.
That make any sense?
No sense, Juan. So I don't want people, just because he got a couple dollars and he think he could just come in and get, just because he white, he could think and he just stamping his feet. It ain't like that, man. I'm Bahamian, and I'm Bahamian. First and foremost, I'm Bahamian. It ain't about color. It's about me being persistent and sinking my teeth in and I ain't letting go of it.
Right. Well, Toby, I can vouch for you. You're nothing if not persistent. That I know. This says, if the PLP don't approve Toby's project, there's no believing in Bahamians from the government.
Yeah. Well, the good thing about a cabinet conclusion is that that's approved. That's gone to the Governor General. It goes through to the Queen, or now the King. But once a cabinet conclusion is done, then they have the obligation to follow through on what has been approved.
Mm-hmm. Okay, this says, good afternoon, Juan and Toby. I'm a young Bahamian architect who's very interested in creating a presentation when Toby's given the green light so that he can lay out a proposal idea. I currently live in the U.S. working, but I always come home and never forget where I come from.
Good.
I've done numerous presentations before. If my work can be recognized in a foreign land, it can certainly be recognized here. So, Toby, I'll be waiting for when that time comes. Keep fighting, brother.
I appreciate
my support.
Thanks for the voucher support. And you think about it, Juan. So it's not just, okay, so what's this beach club going to entail? You're going to have people, you're going to have chefs, you're going to have this, you're going to have that, right? But when you look at, for instance, Bahamian architects, I'm not interested in whatsoever in using a foreign architect. When you look at the architectural renditions and all these different services that are needed, surveys and structural engineers and all these kind of things. Look at RCL's proposal that they put in, right, with town planning. And on the bottom of the architectural plans, it'll say who the different service providers are, who did the concept, who did the architectural, who did the engineer. It's all foreign.
Mm-hmm.
It's all foreign. Or they might get a Bahamian architect just to rubber stamp it for the plans that were drawn up in the States or China or wherever's cheap, right, for a Bahamian to rubber stamp and endorse it. So what's our project all about? It's all about hiring Bahamians, not just for the frontline workers, but also outside of those ancillary services where we'll be buying from local food producers, farms in Eleuthera, farms in Andrus, right? Supporting these people that really and truly need the support But that then, it's not only that the revenues stay in the Bahamas, but those revenues are spent with local providers through their services or through their goods.
This is a great show. As usual, tell Toby he should have let Sam or Billy ask for the land.
Yeah, boy. I'll be very frank. I did actually approach FDX because they seem to be the only ones to be able to get things done in town, but I wasn't given any response. But yeah, I'm hitting it out of the park. I'll try whatever. And for that, it would be that, hey, can you put in a good word for me was all I was wanting to say, you know, listen to my project. Do you support it? Since you got everybody in government here, then put in a good word for me.
Yeah, well, I'm hoping that you get straight, Toby, because, you know, I don't see any reason why you wouldn't. And, you know, like I said,
I appreciate it.
Dave, I believe that Brave Davis is a man who believes in the Heyman upliftment and entrepreneurship. And
I do too.
Sure, people get a chance.
I do too. And and he said it publicly. So I just need him to please follow through on that. Mr. Prime Minister, I'd appreciate it. I'm ready to go. Chester Cooper, I'm also ready to go. And anyone else that's out there listening that's got any doubts, I'm ready.
All right. This says, keep up the good fight, Toby. We need someone who really cares about and values our culture. We pay lip service to culture, but we keep elevating foreigners who almost completely water down our culture. Let a Bahamian have an opportunity to shine.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I mean, culture and, like, even cultural misappropriation that they've taken Little Stirrups Key, taken the Bahamian name away from it, and call it Coco Key.
All right. We got to go. We got to get out of here. Okay.
All right.
So
thank you.
We got to wrap up. Toby, great to see you, man.
Always
keep
a pleasure.
Keep me updated on any developments that are going on with your project.
I will.
And we're here rooting for you, man.
Thank you very much. Bahamas, I appreciate you all rooting for me, too. Juan, I appreciate being on your show and your public support of me. There's lots of others that are supporting me, and I haven't been in the news. I've just been laying low, hoping that the government is going to feel compelled towards not holding me back and let me go full force.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
All right. So Ken and Eat's going to be here tomorrow, Lord willing. I'll be back on Monday, and we will talk some more about what's going on in the country and other issues as well. You guys take care out there, and have a great day, Bahamas.